blood poured out for us, seed of every curse upon him. Final breath to give, his head a little to wear. Son of God is laid in darkness, battling the grave. The war of death is waged, power fell forever broken. We sing hallelujah, the Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, the Lamb has overcome. Forever He is Lord. Lifted high.
Hi everyone, good morning. Welcome once again to Lakelands at Home. Thanks for connecting in with us again. Good to have you. This morning I have, I think, a simple but an important word for us today. Can we read four verses from Matthew together, please? Matthew chapter 5. Matthew 5, and we're going to begin at verse 13. You are the salt of the earth, but what good is salt if it has lost its flavour? Can you make it salty again? It will be thrown out and trampled underfoot as worthless. You are the light of the world, like a city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. No one lights a lamp and then puts it under a basket. Instead, a lamp is placed on a stand where it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your good deeds shine out for all to see, so that everyone will praise your heavenly Father. So these verses are taken from the Sermon on the Mount, the single longest sermon of Jesus recorded in Scripture, and it's a really wide-ranging sermon. And you know, funny enough, today you might well be taught that when you're preaching a sermon that you only have three or four or maybe 5 points at most. But listen, the Sermon on the Mount by the Master, it is dozens and dozens of points. And you know what's more, it covers such a wide range of topics. But in a nutshell, the Sermon on the Mount is a description of kingdom life. It's a description of the Christian life lived in obedience to God. And another way that you could look at it is to say this. You could say it's a reflection of the character of Christ. That character that we as Christians, that we take on, that we are being transformed into through the washing of the word, through the renewing of the mind. And in these verses that we have just read, Jesus uses two words, two metaphors, if you like, to describe his disciples, those who are following him, truly following Christ, not just in name, but in deed and in obedience. And those two words, they are salt and light. And they're two words that were very well known and completely understood by the original hearers, just as they are by us today. Both are valuable, both are useful, but they do tend to operate in very different ways if you think about it. Salt, when it's applied, you know, it's rarely seen. It's absorbed, it's taken in, it's internal and it's hidden for the most part. And it fulfills its purpose hidden from view. It works in secret, as it were. But light's the complete opposite, actually. Light is something that's external. Light is seen. Actually, if you think about it, if light can't be seen, then it's not light. And I don't mean that when it's hidden, you know, that we read about earlier. If light exists, it's seen. And both affect and influence and change their surroundings. And when Jesus uses it as metaphors for us in this kind of great revealing of kingdom life in this sermon, it means that we, our lives lived for Jesus. It means that we're to influence and we are to change our surroundings for the glory of God. Verse 16. So salt and light. And yeah, they do speak of two very, very different things. And sometimes, you know, even as we might read these few verses, perhaps in our minds we kind of think of them separately. You know, well, there's salt and then there's light. But in this context, in what Jesus is saying here, they are inextricably linked. They cannot be separated. Without salt and the work of salt, there will be no light. And it's firstly salt in the life of the individual. And, you know, we can refer to some of the qualities of salt here, because salt in your life and mine can be seen as the internal work, the cleansing and transforming work of the Holy Spirit in each of us. You see, salt purifies and cleanses, doesn't it? Just as the Holy Spirit works in us, purifying us, cleansing us, as he transforms us into the image of Christ. 2 Corinthians 3:18. And we shall all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. We're being transformed into the same image as Jesus. But, you know, obviously we know that it doesn't mean physically. We're not all going to physically look like Jesus, are we? We don't even know what he looked like, to be honest. No, we're not. Remember, salt works internally. It's in secret. So when the Bible says we're being transformed into the same image as Jesus, it means that the salt, it means that the Holy Spirit is bringing about internal change. It's talking about our character, so that our character mirrors and reflects the character of Jesus. Let me read Philippians 2, 5 to 8. I'll give you a wee second if you want to read along with this one. Philippians chapter 2, beginning at verse 5. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of man, and being found in human form. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. This is how the NLT words these very same verses. Listen to this. You must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. He took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on a cross. Day and daily, as we allow him, the salt, the Holy Spirit is at work within each one of us. Dealing with our old desires, he's replacing them with new desires. Dealing with the old attitudes, the old prejudices that we all have, replacing them with the agape love that we see in Jesus. Dealing with our pride, replacing it with the humility that we just read about in Jesus. Anger and frustration replaced with patience and understanding that we see in Jesus. Selfishness with a desire to be the servant of all, just as Christ came not to be served, but to serve. Changing receiving into a desire to give, and Jesus gave everything. And on that list goes, as the character of Jesus is formed within each one of us. And this is where light comes in. As the character of Christ is formed in us by salt, as the work of salt produces its results, as it were, it becomes noticeable. It can be seen. It will be noticed. Probably, first of all, by those closest to us who know us best. They will see a change in us. And you know, it'll be a good change. It'll be a positive change. It'll be an attractive change. We will begin to shine for Jesus. And the more we allow the salt to work, the more we cooperate, the more we are obedient, to the leading and to the prompting and guiding of the Holy Spirit, the greater the transformation and the brighter that we shine. You know, and as verse 16 of our first reading said, we glorify or bring praise to our Father in heaven. Our lives become lights, shining brightly. Not so that we can be noticed as such, but we light up a path to Jesus. Do you know, there's much that we can be doing, and there's much that we should be doing. You know, to reach others, to help others, to care for others, for Jesus. It's why we're here. That's why we haven't been taken straight to heaven. But even though there's much that we can and much that we should be doing, the single most effective, the greatest ever attraction to Jesus is and always has been Jesus himself. And the more we reflect Jesus in our lives, the greater that attraction is to, you know, to those around us. And it's not just initial change in us, by the way, which can be very dramatic sometimes, you know, when we get saved. It's ongoing change that is noticed too. And the more that we reflect the image, reflect the character of Jesus, the brighter we shine for him, and the greater the attraction. So that's salt and light in the individual. And that's what Jesus is talking about here too, about how when the salt has worked its purpose deep within each one of us, we then become salt and light ourselves in our communities, in our families, our neighbourhoods, and in our culture and society. And listen, here are just a few effects of that salt in our culture. Just as salt seasons and flavours food and it enhances that which it comes into contact with. Now, think back yourself of some of the food that you've tasted over the years. You know, today there's actually a great health drive to reduce our intake of things like salt and of sugar, and rightly so, because we really have become accustomed to kind of too much of it, too much of either of them in our food and in our drink. But if it's taken to the extremes with the salt, removing it completely, then there's so much food becomes virtually tasteless, bland. In fact, it can even sometimes go to the extent that foods that we once liked, they'll now taste bad. Yet with just a shake or two of that wee salt cellar, suddenly everything's all right again. The food is bursting with flavour. You see, salt has the ability to intensify agreeable tastes and to diminish disagreeable tastes all at the same time. So translate into the context, into our context today that we're talking about. Being salt in our society, we intensify those things around us that are agreeable to God. And we diminish those things that are disagreeable to God. That's the effect we have. We enhance the flavour and fragrance of the kingdom, and we diminish the flavour and fragrance of this world. Salt's also a preservative. The application of salt is one of the oldest methods used to help preserve and to keep food, to make it last longer, to, you know, it helps to preserve and hold back rot and decay. But listen, notice that once it's there, it doesn't get rid of it. That's a kind of a different story, and probably more to do with the light, really. But it doesn't get rid of it. But being there, it helps prevent it in the first place, and it helps hold it back from spreading and getting worse. And so too is our presence to help preserve our society from rot and from decay, preserving against moral corruption, preserving a godly influence all around us. Salt also contains certain healing qualities. Salt helps with skin problems and irritations on the skin, things like psoriasis or eczema. Saline sprays are used to combat blocked and runny noses. Baking soda, which sodium bicarbonate, it's a type of salt, but baking soda is a great antacid. It's used to treat insect bites or stings from insects or plants, and hives and other things that cause itching. Sore throat, bad breath, gurgle and mouthwash with salt water, and so on. You know, lots of different things. Quite wide-ranging healing uses have been used for many years. As salt in society, we are able to help, bring help and healing to those who are broken and are hurting, physically, emotionally, and particularly spiritually. And the last kind of quality that I'll mention about salt today, because there are more, there are actually quite a lot more, but the last thing I'm going to mention today is this. Salt makes you thirsty, doesn't it? And we living our lives in obedience to Jesus, reflecting of the image of Jesus as we are transformed into his likeness, we will. Notice, listen, I say we will. It's not I might or perhaps or it could happen. Just like natural salt creates a natural thirst, so too spiritual salt will create a spiritual thirst, a thirst for God, a thirst for the things of God. Let's be salt. Let's be spiritual salt in our community for Jesus, for the kingdom, for the glory of God. So let's look at light. Salt has done, and it's continually doing its work within us, as we say. It's continually transforming us, changing us, as it does, we begin to shine all the brighter and brighter and brighter for Jesus. In what, by any stretch of the imagination, guys, it's a very dark world today. Both salt and light have the ability to influence and to change their worlds. And just as we considered some of these qualities or influences of salt, let's now look at light. And the first thing to say is this: light has power. Light conquers darkness. You know, back before all of these kind of lockdowns and all these restrictions and whatnot, do you remember those days? Yeah, in the distant past when you could just get into your car and go wherever you wanted? Yeah. Anyway, back before all these lockdowns and all these kind of restrictions and whatnot, Leslie and I went out for a run in the car one day. And we ended up over in, on the west of Ireland, Achill Island. And then when we came off the island, we turned left, basically headed north, not really knowing where we were going. We were just driving about. We were looking around us and seeing where we would end up. And then seemingly in the middle of nowhere, we came across a place called Ballycrory National Park and Visitor Centre. So we decided to call in and see if we got a wee cup of coffee and maybe something for lunch. So we went in and we placed an order, sat down. But as it happened, on that particular day, believe it or not, or as luck would have it, their card reading machine, you know, for the credit card or debit card, was faulty. And we didn't have enough cash on us to pay for what we'd ordered, and it was on our table. But there was a very kind man who was there. He saw what had happened and he looked after it for us. It wasn't a big meal or anything like that. But I actually ended up then in a conversation with him. And, you know, we didn't know this because we'd basically kind of just stumbled across that place really by accident. But we learned that where we were was regarded as one of the physically darkest places in Ireland. And it was one of the best places to go to look at the stars at night. It's known as the Mayo Dark Sky Park. And the reason it's so good for viewing those stars is simple. It's because there's virtually no light pollution whatsoever. And when it gets dark there, it gets dark. So just think of the darkest place that you have ever known, the darkest place imaginable for you. If you strike even just a single match, light a single candle, light up one torch, that light will conquer the darkness. Even the smallest of lights has the power to overcome and to drive away, to push away oppressive darkness. And it's the same for us in a spiritual sense, guys. When we shine for Jesus in this dark world, you know, Jesus said of himself in John 8:12, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. And as we reflect Jesus, as we mirror Jesus, we bring his light into this dark world. At the start, we were told that we were the light of the world. That's what it means. And we and those around us walking in darkness, we stumble, we fall, we don't know where we're going. We can't see where we're going. And guys, just pause and think about it for a second or two. That's an accurate description of this world and the people in it today. Yet when the light comes, Psalm 119:30, the unfolding of your words give light. It imparts understanding to the simple. The same Psalm, verse 105, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. When the light comes, it reveals the direction we're going and it prevents us from going the wrong way. Just as the light from a lighthouse shining out warns of the dangers ahead so that ships and sailors can avoid that danger. And not only that, but just as the light of the star led the wise men to Jesus as they followed it, as we shine in this world, we too light the way. We show the way to Jesus, to those around us. Light brings life. Without light, all life on earth would cease to exist. And every day as the sun rises, it brings light to provide growth and warmth and on this earth. And as we shine for Jesus, we allow his light to bring life to those walking in darkness around us. We light the way to life, eternal life. Light brings life. Do you know, without light, there'd be no colour. The world was such a drab place without it. Do you know, the colours that we see, the wide, wide spectrum of colours that we see, are really just light reflected back to us. Think of a night time. Actually, no. Think of a beautiful garden full of lots and lots of different flowers during the day. And our eyes are nearly assaulted by the explosion of colour that we see in it. But look at that same garden at night. And that explosion kind of disappears. You might still have a hint of colour. But for the most part, as you look around you at all those different flowers again, all you'll really see are different shades of grey, kind of blending together. But as we shine for Jesus, we bring his light to bear on an otherwise drab, dreary world. And in the light of Jesus, the world becomes a much more colourful and beautiful place. Do you know, I've experienced this myself, when I get saved, and I've heard the same story from, quite a few people now. But once the light of Jesus enters our lives in salvation, the whole creation around us just seems to take on a whole new life itself. Colours and shapes and textures, everything appears much more colourful, much more beautiful and exciting. Jesus doesn't just bring life, he brings abundant life. And that's just some of the effects, some of the influences that we are to have in this world as we are salt and as we are light in our families, in our neighbourhoods, workplaces, or wherever. So far, you know, we've been looking just really at the individual, haven't we? The single person. As salt and light. But what happens then when these people, those who are shining for Jesus, what happens when they come together? When they begin to congregate together, when they worship together, when they pray together and shine together. Read verse 14 again that we read, you know, way back at the beginning. It says, "You are the light of the world, like a city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden." When we come together as God's family, shining individually, but we come together, we become a city set on a hill that can be seen from far away. That concentrated light from that city shines out far and wide, well beyond where an individual light can reach. Well beyond. And there's a picture that I really like it, because it's a picture of Ireland. It's taken from space, taken at night, and I really think it helps explain what we've been talking about. Let me show it to you. You can see many different lights there, dotted all over, north, south, east and west. And to me, those lights represent the individual, bringing their light, the light of Jesus, to their own individual areas. But then you look closer, and in the picture, you can, well, we know where it is. I know you can see Dublin, you can see Belfast, Cork, Galway, Sligo. And they remind me of what happens when the family of God comes together. It's concentrated. Those places on the picture, well, they literally are cities, but when we come together, shining together for Jesus, we become cities set on a hill, shining, witnessing, living others to Jesus. And I just think it's so amazing, it's so wonderful, it's such a privilege that we have, that we are called to be salt and light for him. Going to close today firstly by reminding ourselves of these verses in Matthew chapter 5. You are the salt of the earth, but what good is salt if it has lost its savour, flavour? Can you make it salty again? It will be thrown out and trampled underfoot as worthless. You are the light of the world, like a city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. No one lights a lamp and then puts it under a basket. Instead, a lamp is placed on a stand where it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your good works, your good deeds, shine out for all to see, so that everyone will praise your heavenly Father. And that's what it's all about. It's bringing glory and honour and praise to God. And we're going to finish today with a song. It's an old song, and it's a song that I suppose could be considered a children's song. But in the light of, and there's no pun intended there, but in the light of what we have looked at today, such a fitting song to close with. And let it be an encouragement. Let it be an encouragement to us all to let our light, our little light, shine for Jesus. God bless and protect you through this incoming week.